Mini Chapter 10, Angles of Glamour. At 9 next morning, referring to the letter of intent that Mark and I signed, I make a round of calls from my home phone to several high-powered intellectual property lawyers to ascertain which one I'll be instructing with regard to the protection of my and Alaya's rights in this broadcast. Once that ball is rolling, I head to my workplace in the mid-morning to take charge of the pressing of the button to the SEC at noon on behalf of the prospectus team, which goes as smoothly as I could have hoped. The customary post-button-pressing celebrations pass with great and forgettable pleasantness, whereafter I take immediate advantage of my hard-earned brownie points by arranging to take a couple of weeks off, citing vague holiday plans. In the early afternoon, I visit the lawyer I've selected to represent Alaya and me, one Bedford Pickering III, in his offices on Broad Street, sign some paperwork with him, and make an advance payment against some very fat fees. Then, in the late afternoon, Alaya and I have an appointment at the General Network to meet a trusted deputy of Mark's who will oversee our broadcast, one Jason Carax. When she and I arrive, Mark is not in evidence, but a receptionist shows us to a conference room and tells us Mr. Carax will join us soon. As soon as we are left alone, we find ourselves gripped by such a sense of anticipation at the whole direction of events that, with very little warning, our usual professional demeanour devolves into a fit of whispering, nudging, and uncontrollable girlish giggling. Angry at myself, I whisper furiously to her that this is hardly our best self-presentation to the General Network and we should cool it, because it's quite possible we're being seen and heard right now through cameras and microphones hidden around this conference room. Alas, this just sets us both off even more, till we are heaving and drooping off our chairs for minutes on end, with tears of adolescent mirth streaming down our faces. At last we get it together. Really, what was that about? Ridiculous silliness. Mustn't happen again, especially not during the broadcast. But now there are voices down the corridor, and the sound of one person approaching. Curious to see who will enter the room, I see a tall, middle-aged man in a pale grey designer suit coast in through the door with a laid-back tread. His longish, gently streamlined black face is friendly and mild, but his eyes acute. He inclines his head a moment in a suave and understated bow. "Jamie, Alaya, congratulations. You are both now icons," he purrs. Though there's interest and mirth in his eyes, his emotions are hidden. He takes a seat across the conference table. "I'm Jason Carax, VP Live Events. I'll be executive producing, and I'm delighted we could help to put this broadcast event together. Unfortunately, this meeting will have to be a brief one, but we'll no doubt catch up again presently. I'm afraid the Asbury Park soundstage won't be available until the day of the broadcast, but we have world-class facilities here in the city, which my assistant will show you. Meanwhile, if I can be of any help, please don't hesitate to give me a call." And he hands us his card. Tickled by this smooth opacity, I'm curious to take a quick look inside him. Strictly a passive one, of course. And the first thing I find, Jason Carax, is a memory of 20 years ago. You're boarding a bus on which you slip away west across the marshes on the highway from New York to the airport, sealed in your headphones, through airport lounges, over moving tunnel floors, through the gates to a plane, and the music seals you off while you shoot down the runway and climb through the air and curve around and streak across the ocean, sunset crystal through the moving glass, and down again, through gates and further tunnels, to a city where you bus, train and quick change and out through the streets under European skies. You walk, meet and talk, part and meet, look and ride and run and drink. Then you head for another town and start the show again and fix those internet connections and make a rendezvous and shine again with the people. Then slip away, blurred in an audio-electrical cultural haze of many countries, chic hotels and continental glamour, plain wheels and plastic, foreign coins and fluid motion, from nation to nation. London, Paris, Rome, Berlin, Athens, Barcelona, say your eyes. Cities never ending, a playground almost like a video. So come with me now, we'll escape, don't you think? Jason, you manipulator, player, analyzer, this is fun. Fast-tracked yesterday, and there you are planning, scheming, framing, mixing on your laptop and phone and even diagrams on paper. Slip and slide and take us on a streak through the airwaves and out across the web in fashion spreads. Turn poison into mercury and measure our temperatures. Gauge the looks and market them to next year's beat. Is that fire in your eyes or the glow of machines? I take another peek in you to settle this dilemma, and I smile then with pleasure, as a clear, silent stream of words glances through the air at me and onward far beyond me, like quarks in a particle accelerator. Allure is a beautiful lie. Some people have a crackle. My people's people will talk to your people's people. Your entourage will have an entourage. Image as a second language. Plastic daydream. Dying young is such a good career move. I like to pit one demographic against another. I was skinny in Paris. French philosophy has the rigour of a good perfume. Mediagenic. My fire is a glazed fire. There are those who make you and those who buy you. The secret of success is to be the ultimate extreme edition of yourself. It's so sterile, you could write an essay about it. I'm too famous for a business card. It's without irony and defeats any you bring to it. The public wants an icon to be first euphoric, then tragic. It's always reassuring to see other people's frenzy. Making tragedies too obvious, I like to make myth. Abstraction, the perfume. I want to make a drama out of my inability to resolve an identity. If I ran a club, then even if you were refused entry, it would still feel like sex. Perfect, sanitized angst. I'm your wispy myth. I can't breathe in this mask.
What a hoot he is, I do confess. I feel like responding to his quarks with a fillip of hypnosis, saying, okay, Jason, picture me a face like the sound of the slinkiest and coolest pulse of electronic music, with space between the cheekbones of its high flicks of treble and a wet bass weight within those lips I want to kiss upon a poster on my bedroom wall. It's Jamie's face. Mine, the face you need to see on me, for now it's up to you to frame it to perfection for the world. Angles of glamour on a face so bewitching it is painful to the viewer. That's the brief, so get going. Off we go now, chop chop!
That would probably backfire in some way, however, so I strap it down.
Well, thank you, Mr. Carax, I say aloud instead, proffering Bedford Pickering III's card. This is our attorney's card, so I'm sure we'll all be in touch with one another. I give a little bow, like the one he gave to us, and he's gone.
As Alaya and I cross the downstairs lobby together, she mutters, "We'd better deliver."
"We shall."
"By the way, you're not having any secret tune-ins to me, are you?"
"No, of course not. I promised you."
We walk on. Good choice of PIN number for the ATM, though. Nobody would guess it. She hits me on the arm, grinning. But through her grin, I can see she's nervous about the broadcast. So am I. Still, now that I'm getting used to having these new abilities in general, it's become absolutely clear that I was made to possess the power that they give me. This feels like no more than a simple truth. To perceive and appreciate the richest and subtlest elements of a person, instead of just guessing at these elements through an opacity of flesh that lacks the inclination to confirm one's guesses and the verbal ability to convey the same rich information in words, this is merely what I should always have been able to do. Why on earth did I have to wait years for this ability to arrive? What a waste of time. Oh well, better late than never.